Hello, my name is John Stinsel. I live in the town of Kennedy, Massachusetts, and in 2012, I ran for mayor.
Do you think it was a successful run?
Well, how do you define success? You know, is success finding the center of a Tootsie Pop? Is it finding the gates to Valhalla? Or, you know, is it, you know, like coming in last in an election? Because if you come in first, you know, like, yeah, you won, but did you really win, you know?
So you came in last?
Yeah.
What can you tell us about your opponent in the race, Issa Ali?
Oh, Issa, you know, Issa, I liked Issa. Issa, he was a good opponent. You know, he was a great speaker. He really had the voice that people liked. A good debater, he really stuck to the topics during those debates. Great guy all around. I mean, I can't really think of anything particularly bad about him. At the same time, he was terrible. I hated him.
There's no one there.
Yeah.
So, what did you do for work before you ran?
Oh, well, you know, that's a good question. And, so, a lot of people in the area who knew me and voted for me did so because they knew about Mike's Fish, which, of course, was the company that I was CEO and head of at the time. And you know, a lot of people, they come up to me, and they're always like, "Hey, John, your name's John, it's not Mike. Where'd you get Mike's Fish from? Is that like, that's probably like your dad or your grandfather or something, right?" And you know, that's simply not true. Alright, and I really dislike it when people lie about things like that. It's not okay. Back to the topic. So, my best friend growing up, you know, best friend, we did everything together. He actually helped with the campaign, so we've known each other pretty much our whole lives. His name was Paul. And, you know, Paul's dad, you know, I'm a great, welcoming human being, taught me most of the things that I know. His name was Jimmy. And you see, Jimmy's college roommate was also named Paul. You see, this is how he named his son after his college roommate. But that college roommate's dog was named Mike. You know, I that always stuck with me. You know. Kennedy, Massachusetts. I mean, like, how could I dislike such a town, you know? Small, coastal town, you know, about 400 people. We're to, like, about the north, south, east, west area of New England. It's very nice. Not a lot of people know about it. you know, people have always had problems with Kennedy, you know, like, ridiculous problems, you know, many people have accused us of having unstable nuclear power plants, or the fact that our public pool has been infested with raccoons for the past 3.5 years, but these simply aren't the topics that people want to hear about, you know? They want to know about what the price of fish is, or Twinkies, you know? That's what the people of Kennedy care about. That is what they care about. So, people said that I ran a pretty dirty campaign against Issa. You know, they said that I had a lot of attacks against him, that I was a very nasty campaigner. But I don't think that that's entirely true. You know, I did spend $13,000 on a giant blow-up of Issa's head and a word bubble that said, I am going to blow up this town with dynamite and put it in the center of the town. However, I didn't consider that very unorthodox, and I still don't. You know, people have been doing things like that in elections for 1,000 years, you know? It's not that different.
It's not?
No, you know, like, it's the same thing that if, you know, he blew up the town with dynamite and said I did it, you know, these are things that people do, you know.
They are?
You know, the debates were not my finest moments as a candidate. The debates, of course, were televised by the local middle school. However, we did get on national news one time, and that was, of course, the time that I charged Issa on stage with a Bowie knife. You know, what we didn't realize were the amount of elderly Vietnam War veterans in the audience who, after seeing this event, began screaming uncontrollably. We could not get them to stop. It was horrific. I was winning in online polls. So there was that.
My name is Ted Cruz, and I was the former campaign manager for John Stenzel. So, John's a nice guy. He was at a big rally recently, and he was kissing babies, like many politicians do. And there was an outbreak, and there was a couple protesters. There was some pushing. John was pushed. And in retaliation, he turned around and punched the protester who pushed him. Little did he know that the protester had already left, and he ended up punching one of the babies in the face that he had previously kissed. That wasn't very good for his campaign.
So if you wouldn't mind, can we talk about Babygate for a little bit and what that was about?
God, this baby people keep wanting to talk about. That whole incident was the result of this condition that my doctor diagnosed me with, in which when I am, I guess, pushed or touched in a violent way, then I impulsively just, you know, flail around. And so that punch was just the result of that condition. And the fact that the baby was in the way was just, you know, a casualty of that. And the fact that people are accosting me of this condition that I have no control over is just baffling. And, you know, I'm completely offended by it. And I expect apologies, you know, from people at the rally, the protesters, especially the baby. Well, I mean, it worked out all right in the end. I'm his godfather now, so.
Yeah, the campaign was a little rough. I mean, a little mismanagement. I mean, actually, John took money out of the campaign budget to fund his trip to Europe. He thought of me, though. He sent me back some gelato, but by the time it came back, it was melted.
I didn't actually go to Europe. My miles would only take me to Missouri, so I just told everybody that I was going to Italy because I thought it'd be cool. And the gelato that I sent back to Ted wasn't actually gelato, it was just mint chocolate chip ice cream from a place called Maggie the Cow. It was the worst ice cream that I have ever had. I hate Missouri so much.
Throughout the campaign, John had a lot of girlfriends there. There was Deirdre, there was Monica, there was Melissa, there was Stacy, there was Taylor, there was Samantha, there was Jillian. One particular breakup is can always be remembered by John is his breakup with Tiffany, whom he met while pumping ketchup at a Quiznos. Tiffany's breakup really pushed John over the edge. He started firing every woman on his campaign, and that's when it really started to suffer. We started to lose a lot of funding, so.
That wasn't that big a deal, alright? Like, I was going through a bad time, and Tiffany had just left me, and I fired my whole female staff, and people were furious with me. They were like, oh, John is a sexist. And I'm not a sexist. Clearly, I'm not a sexist. It's just after Tiffany broke my heart, I just could never trust another woman again. My mom was working for me, and I fired her. Like, I don't see what's so unfair. It's not that I'm a sexist. I just really hate women.
Yeah, the campaign was a little shaky at points. I mean, there was that time where John went to a after party and got caught up and did a lot of things that night. So he ended up in the Natural History Museum, and he stole a painting from 1718, which he claimed was of his family, but after investigation, they found no traces of relation between him and anyone in that painting. So that was a big mistake.
Okay, you see, this is ridiculous. You know, the guy in the painting, he looked just like me. I thought that he was my grandfather that I never knew. Okay, and then the police were questioning me, and then they said to me, you know, how did I not know that this was a painting from the 1700s, and I didn't know how old he was? Alright? Ridiculous.
Yeah, John had, he had 6 cell phones, and they were all made before 2000. John bought a van off of a guy named Dirty Pete.
Dirty Pete is a good friend of mine. The reason they call him Dirty Pete is because when he was 10 years old, he didn't take a shower every now and again. And he used to smell like banana peels in a garbage can at the dump. You know, like the big, like, the trash compactors at the dump. Like, if you just put, like, a bunch of banana peels in there and then left them there for a week, that was what he would smell like. But that was the only reason that they called him Dirty Pete.
Yeah, John insisted that he was a member of the Whig Party, even though that has not existed for 100 years plus.
So, you were a member of the Whig Party.
Yes, and that's a good topic. I mean, because a lot of people were confused because they said they either didn't know what the Whig Party was, or, you know, they tried to tell me that the Whig Party didn't exist anymore, and I kept telling them, well, it does exist. I'm a part of it, so, you know, it exists. And my knowledge of the Whig Party was what people would call limited. I just assumed that we would be wearing wigs. That was not the case. In fact, I had a large head of hair at the time. I have since got it cut. But I had a very large head of hair at the time, and people said it was too large, and several people, including Issa, accused me of hiding secrets within it. And I understood their concern.
One day, John found a turkey roaming in his backyard, and the next day, there was a proposal for a ban of all turkeys in the town. Yeah, there was a time where he took money out of the campaign funds to buy a real life-sized Daffy Duck for his own personal use. Wouldn't tell us why, wouldn't explain it, and it's still not explained to this day.
Me and Daffy are no longer on speaking terms.
There was that time that he went to the zoo in the middle of the night and decided that it'd be a good idea to wrestle with the bears. And that ended up taking money out of the campaign funds to pay for his medical bills, which he needed many stitches and casts and a lot of medical treatment. A lot of medical treatment. Jeez, sorry. So sorry. Lord, please forgive me.
Hello?
Hello?
You responded to an ad on Craigslist about being in a documentary. You said you had personal connections to the subject.
Hello? Sir?
There's some, what? Hello?
Are you basement liver 144 on Craigslist?
Sir, we have a few questions.
Excuse me.
Oh God, what the? Sir, we just want to talk. All right.
What?
Stop!
My name is Darnell Velociraptor Jones. Okay, so I was trying to help out John's campaign, and I was trying to get some money. So I made a deal with this, I'll admit, pretty sketchy human being. And he happened to be part of the Mexican cartel. And he then starts going on talking about shipping drugs across the border and the border police, and it got all haywire, and I didn't want to do it. And then after that, it was just kind of fuzzy. I don't know what happened. And then now I'm being hunted, and I think they're still friends because they're really nice, but they're still like hunting me and want to kill me.
So why did you initially support John?
The aliens, they took my cousin. His name's Albert. And they told him stuff, and then after that, there was Bigfoot in the newspaper one day, and then the aliens and Bigfoot made a baby, and it was Big Alien Foot, and it was scary. Thank you.
Now, how does that relate to John's campaign?
Who's that?
So, which political...
They're here.
He's here. Come back. No. So about Darnell Velociraptor Jones.
We're not going to mention him in this interview. I am dead serious. We do not talk about that man. Next question.
So you raised nearly $5 million for your campaign. How did a small mayoral campaign acquire such funds?
Well, you know, we were a pretty good campaign. And that's a common question, though. Like, how could our campaign raise that much money off donations? And we had our methods. We had one that we called forced funding, and what forced funding pretty much was that we would go to people's houses and we would ask them to give us their money for the good of the cause. And you know, they'd say like, what cause? You know, like ridiculous questions like that. And as the founding father Paul Revere once said, if people do not give you what you want when you ask for it, you stand outside their houses at night and you scream. And so what we did was we got opera singers from the Boston Opera House, we placed them outside these people's houses, and we didn't ask them to sing. We asked them to scream. And have you ever heard an opera singer scream before?
No.
It's horrific. But it worked, and, you know, we got the donations.
But didn't a lot of that funding come from the Free Kennedy PAC run by Darnell Velociraptor Jones?
I literally just told you we're not going to mention the Donald. Okay, fine, I'll talk about Darnell. I met Darnell at a very bad place in my life. I met him 2 years before the campaign even started. And we met through the local fight club. We liked the movie, okay? We liked the movie, all right? It turns out that real fight club is not like it is in the movie, and you don't end up destroying federal banks at the end. So we decided we'd run for mayor. And, you know, Darnell just wouldn't stop talking about aliens. It got to the point where I legitimately considered calling the police, because he was turning my house into a makeshift UFO using a toaster and a television set. And I was not happy, to say the least. And I asked him about it. I said, Darnell, like, what's your end game with this? Like, what are you even doing? And he just said to me, it's just a thing, man. He had this, like, Matthew McConaughey-type calmness to him. It was terrifying.
Hi, sir. How you doing? I'm calling on behalf of John Stinzel. He's running for mayor in the upcoming election. I'd like to ask you a question or two, if that's okay.
Yep, that's fine.
Hi. Who will you be voting for in the upcoming election?
I'll be voting for John Stinzel.
Oh, good. Any particular reasons why?
John Stinzel's a class act guy. I just feel like he's the right choice for mayor.
Okay, thank you, sir. Hi, ma'am. How are you doing today?
I'm well, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. I'm calling on behalf of John Stinzel. He's running for mayor in the upcoming election. I was wondering if I could ask you a question or two.
That's fine.
Who are you thinking about voting for in this upcoming election?
Well, John Stinzel, of course.
Any particular reason why you'd vote for John Stinzel?
Oh my God, I love John Stinzel. I see all over town. I feel like he is the right choice for mayor.
Thank you, ma'am. Hi, ma'am. How you doing today?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. I'm calling on behalf of John Stinzel. He's running for mayor in the upcoming election. Can I ask you?
Oh, John Stinzel.
Can I ask you a question or two, ma'am? Who are you thinking about voting for in the upcoming election?
Well, John Stinzel, of course.
Any reasons why you would vote for John Stinzel?
Well, I feel like the Latin gods told me to vote for John Stinzel.
Well, thank you, ma'am, very much.
You're welcome.
Hi, sir. How are you doing today?
Who is
it? I'm calling on behalf of John Stinzel. He's running for mayor in the upcoming election. I was wondering if I could ask you a question
I don't
or two.
Care.
Sir?
I do
sir,
not care.
Sir, could I ask you a question or two?
No.
Please, sir, who are you voting for in the upcoming election, sir?
I don't care. I don't care about mayors. I don't care about towns. Get off the phone.
Sir, hello?
Nope, not doing
hello?
It.
Hello?
See ya. Hello? Buddy.
Hello? I think he hung up.
Nope.
Wait, are you still there, sir?
Nope.
Sir, I can hear you on the phone.
Can't.
Sir? Hi, ma'am. How you doing today? I'm calling on behalf of John Stinzel. He's running for mayor in the upcoming election.
Oh, really? John Stinzel?
Yes. Do you mind if I ask you a question or two about the upcoming election?
Sure.
Ma'am, who are you thinking about voting for in this upcoming election?
John Stinzel, of course.
Can I have a reasoning for that?
John Stinzel is a brilliant man. Do you know who was also a brilliant man? Furtava. Furtava was a brilliant man. He committed his life to chemistry and everything involved with the periodic table.
Ma'am, I'm not sure how Fritz Haber is involved with John Stinzel here.
Well, actually, they are exactly alike, sir.
How so?
They're both brilliant men.
Could you elaborate on that?
He would contribute so much to the scientific world.
John Stenzel knows nothing about science, ma'am. He's a politician.
You don't know that.
Ma'am, I'm his campaign manager. I think I do.
He might be telling you some stuff. He might not be telling you some stuff that I know.
Ma'am, I'm gonna hang up now, ma'am. Hello, sir. I'm calling on behalf of John Stenzel. He's running for mayor in the upcoming election.
Who?
John Stenzel.
What? What are you saying?
I said John Stenzel in the upcoming election. He's running for mayor.
The NSA? Did you just say the NSA?
No, running for mayor in the election.
I cannot hear you.
John Stenzel, running for mayor. Yes, yes. I was wondering if I could ask you a question or two.
No problem.
Who are you voting for in this upcoming election?
Not John Stenzel.
How come? Hello, sir? Oh, jeez.
So, what are some general things that you took away from this campaign?
Well, you know, I've learned a few things. One thing I learned... You can't run a campaign like you would a campaign in middle school where you say, you know, free recess all the time, which of course was one of my main points in my actual campaign, was to have recess all the time, which was, you know, it worked great with the elementary and middle school students. But as I later found out, they were ineligible to vote.
Do you have any regrets at all about the campaign?
I'd say my one regret is that I was never endorsed by Gary Johnson.
Who is that?
Well, you know, Gary Johnson is actually the former governor of New Mexico. I've been a fan of Gary for a long time, you know. Because one day, a little while ago, I was watching the TV, and then a fish man came on screen. And I said to myself, that man is going to be the next president of the United States of America.
And, why did you expect his endorsement?
Fish.
So there's been talk of you actually running again for mayor of Kennedy in the future.
Yes, I've heard those rumors. I can't say that they're true. But Kennedy's been good to me. You know, I've lived here all my life. I've made so many great friends here. And just had so many good memories from my childhood. But everyone here is terrible. So I'm leaving. I'm going to leave forever, and just to make my point, I have decided that I will be running for President of the United States of America with my running mate, Jesse Ventura.
What? I've worked on documentaries for about 10 years now. And as I've learned in my experience, there are going to be projects that you work on that they're going to start out a way and they're going to go exactly how you think they're going to go. Then there's documentaries that you start out on, you have no idea where they're going, and they unfold before your eyes. I'm still not positive what this is. But I'm fairly sure John's locked me in his house, okay? If someone's watching this, his address is 27 Burnstone.
Oh, okay, no. Say no to that. I guess the message of this is, follow your dreams, kids.
Changes no one that I love to talk to.
Okay, yes, I've been addicted to sniffing glue for about 6 years now. Are you happy? Yes, I have. Great. All right, this interview is over. Thank you. That's a wrap!